Hello, today we are meeting Max Spiers for the second time and we'll be talking about incredible stuff. Hello, Max.
Hi, Alec.
Let's start with the topic of usefulness. Why we are talking about those nice stuff and not nice and also traumatizing stuff. Why we, some people say that we reinforce the trauma in people. So, how much useful is that for the cleaning of this mess?
The trauma has happened. It's definitely happened. Mm-hmm. There are millions of people who've come forward and said it, and their stories from a line from all over the world. So it's like we know it's happened. So the next step after that would be then to process the feelings and get them out, because it has to be done in stages. So if we're going to break down this paradigm that we're stuck in, this loop that we're stuck in, you have to do it in stages, steps. So the second step would be to, the first step would be to acknowledge the fact that it did happen.
Yes.
And then the second step would be to, it happened. Okay, now what are we going to do? How are we going to deal with dealing with it? If it's not fear mongering, if it's the truth, how can it be?
Mm-hmm.
How can it be? If something's the truth, it's the truth.
So the truth must come out,
yeah.
And then those who can do something with that, they can do it.
Yeah.
But others, they can just.
Some people don't
do whatever they can.
Don't want to. Some people don't want to deal with it. So I've met a few people who know that it's happened to them, but are not interested in going down there to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
So they will stay in an addicted state. Most likely, if they don't. But so there are people who don't want to face it and don't want to deal with it because they're too frightened. Because it takes a brave soul to go and start looking at the rabbit hole and what's happened.
Okay, let's jump to the topic of the Fourth Reich.
Uh-huh.
So how do you place those two groups, Fourth Reich and
Zionists? Okay, I was thinking about this the other day as well. In all words, there's truth hidden in all words, and in the phonetic sounding of the words, and in the writing of the words too. If you look at the word Zion, you just change a vowel around, and you have and switch the letters around, and you have Nazi. You have the word Nazi. I don't believe that they were always running with each other. I do believe they were at odds. This is a war that stems back 50,000 years. They just weren't called Nazis and Zionists. That's just a modern day nom that that they're using. But but I believe because they have the same agenda, because they both have the same, they both want to implement or put into place the new world order, that they're sort of working together now and doing, working in alignment with each other, but in fight, because people with egos or beings with egos like that will always in fight and will always betray the other, but are aligned. I would say aligned.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, if divide and conquer is their thing, division is their thing. If someone controls something completely, you have to always control both sides. So if you want to control a football match, you've got to make sure that you have control, not just the best team, you've got to have control of both the teams. And so the principle is, they're working like this, but maybe shouting at each other on the way.
So if these are two groups, it means that they have someone over them.
There's always a single consciousness at the top, one, and then down pyramid. But there's always a single consciousness. I say consciousness, not being or entity, because it's a consciousness, because these consciousnesses are so if that's a word, consciousness is so powerful that they work through thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of different bodies at once. So I can't really call it he or she or it. Mm-hmm. It's many, many things.
Hive mind?
Sure, sure. Queen bee, hive mind. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, Pindar is over there?
Right. Well, but, that would be, Pindar would be the go-between between the underground crew and the overground crew. The underground ones work, anything below is anything underground is working subconscious. So they do all the subconscious work below ground. Anything above ground is the conscious mind, because that's just the nature of the philosophy of that. So he would be the go-between from the subconscious to the conscious mind. So he will be given orders or will be told what to do from the subgroup, and then will go and then deal with and then implement. They have structured 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, 15 year, and 30 year plan. 30 year plan sets, mm-hmm, that they follow, and he sort of puts that together. I suppose you sort of could call him maybe like an archetypical Luciferian sort of character. That's sort of in my mind sort of how I see it.
Okay, you said under and over. So explain, there are underground bases.
Underground bases, sure, yes.
And
but underground world, an entire world. It's hollow, is it? The Earth is hollow, so it's not an entire
many
world. Oceans and
many
jungles.
Bases under oceans, yeah. Underground, like under the city of London.
Yeah, the CLC one base.
Okay, what is there?
That's all the financial moves for the entire planet are done in the CLC one base. That's, mm-hmm, that's where I mean. There's also military training, and those military ops training programs that go on there as well. But primarily, the money moves are done there.
Mm-hmm. And Pindar. Mm. Physically is a human being or something else?
He can be anything he wants to be.
Okay.
Yeah, but yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. To anything.
Mm-hmm.
Because he has, so to be able to do that, you'd have to have a complete understanding of DNA codes. And once you do understand how DNA codes lock and unlock, it's not actually that difficult to do that. So we
in this, 3D?
Yes. If you want, I don't understand how to do it. But if you do, once you do, you can, you could be anything. You could be any object.
Uh-huh. Do you know the name Elena Kapulnik?
Not too well, but I've heard. I've heard it. Yeah.
Yeah. She's a super soldier, and she met through her astral body, she contacted Queen Elizabeth, and the Queen told her that,
yeah,
she's 7,000 years old reptilian.
Right.
How would you comment that?
Yeah, no, I would probably agree with that. I don't know the specifics like you said, but I mean, I wouldn't doubt that. And body jumping from body to body, when the body wears out, jump from to the next body,
mm-hmm,
through eye transfer. So they'll take the point of death of the person, they'll draw the energy from the eyes and then take the soul comes out through the eyes, and then you can go in through the eyes
of a child.
Yes.
And replace the
yes,
the
switch
soul.
It up. Yeah, and keep that one. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The awareness level also stays. The awareness level stays. So she would not lose her memories like we do. When we
yes,
go through
yes.
our cycle, we have amnesia.
So she remembers everything
yes.
from 7,000 years.
Yes. Yes, full memory. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And, some aside question.
Mm-hmm.
In some interviews, you look like you are kind of bored, that you sit and just look like, I don't know, kind of sleeping, bored.
Yeah.
Why is that?
I know. I think you asked me that earlier. I don't know. I think sometimes some certain topics probably put me into a state of mind that throw me off balance, and because all of this stuff is extremely sensitive, and that's the best you're gonna get from me with that one.
In Rothschild family, it's a huge family, and they have internal fighting. Some super soldiers were used as assassins to get rid of some members of the family. Do you know something about that?
Don't want to talk too much about Michael, but that's his story. I think I want to leave that one alone, and and he it's available to go and have a look at. I'd rather, I feel for him, and I forgive him, and I'd like to know where he is and what's going on and if he's all right. And but I don't want to touch his story at all, because it's his.
Chemtrails, why are they spread?
So I think in the same, like, principally the same, and for the same reasons, with toothpaste and with hairspray and with deodorant and with creams and all of those things, is this is to dumb down, to make subservient, to add heavy metals to the body, to generally make the population more subservient. So this is, it's just an extra arm of that field.
It's a part of the quiet war.
Silent weapons for a quiet war.
Yes.
It's just we all know about it now. I mean, we've been conditioned so much that that even, like, I saw a Dis the Disney movie, some Disney movies, they even have in the sky, in the Dis they have chemtrails in the sky of the Disney movies. So they're conditioning the children to accept that, when 20 years ago we never ever saw anything like that. So it's so well conditioning. Disney being one of the primary child recruiting and MK centers on the planet.
Also, to prevent the sunlight to reach people in enough to enough level so that the consciousness of humanity would raise, because the sunlight
So
is
the sunlight
beneficial.
raises your energy. Absolutely. So they would, when it's a nice day outside, and you get the chemtrails block it off, it takes the life-giving energy away from us. And so all the propaganda lies on the television about stay out of the sun are just that, propaganda, because the sun gives you incredible healing energy.
The sun does not cause cancer, only
No.
the sun lotions cause
Right, there you go. Right,
cancer.
there you go. There you go.
And also, they spread nanotechnology in those.
Right. It sort of rains down, right?
Underground subshuttle. Have you traveled? Actually, what is the subshuttle?
This is the, I have an understanding of it, because I was given all the information, or told all the information about it. But it is electromagnetic rail system that is dug all through the core of the Earth, and reaches speeds of like 3,000 to 4,000 miles an hour through magnetic pull. So you can go, so you could essentially do New York to London in an hour to do what you need to do. And it's all the bases are connected. There's Australia, there are so many bases in Australia. People don't think about that and don't talk about it very much. Also, you know, what's the slang term for Australia? Is Oz. Oz. Well, Oz is slang for Osiris, too. So it's male energy there. There's something to do with the ritual, the Isis, Osiris, and Horus ritual, and Australia is representing Osiris.
And Oz, like the
I'm
magician from
earwigged.
the story.
Yeah, absolutely. They, of course, well, the Wizard of Oz is the Wizard Osiris. Yeah.
And subshuttle is the stations for going on the subshuttle are usually under Hilton Hotel.
Hilton's the Hilton is completely in sync with this whole with them. Yeah, Hilton's run with them and work with them. Certain rooms in certain Hiltons, guests go in and then they will go into an astral state in that room and they will have a meeting in 4D in these certain rooms. Yeah.
After our first interview, some people said that why didn't I ask you to move some objects?
Right.
Because you said that you were teaching that boy to
Yes.
move objects. So
Yes.
explain why.
Right. Okay. So most of the training is done in 4D. Most of the organization and most of the planning and all of that is done in 4D. In 4D is a much more fluid frequency. It's not dense and heavy like this. It doesn't mean that I probably couldn't if I was in a certain state, but as it stands, I'm in a front altar. This person here can't do that like that. But in 4D, I can because I did. So if we're understanding that 3D is much denser, and so that's why.
So for 3D, you need like
I would still say it's possible to do it though. You need a jolt of energy, pretty powerful jolt of energy. But I think I had the potential to be able to do it. Objects fall down. I've had objects, things crack, glasses crack, things fall off windows, window sills, things like this. When my energy is spiked, if I'm agitated, it's just generally if I'm the more agitated I get, things start falling.
The topic of addictions of
Yeah.
the reptilians,
Huh.
like humans have some addictions like alcohol, drugs, sugar, this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Reptilians have different
Are addicted to fear?
addictions, yeah,
Right.
addiction to torture, to
Yes.
this energy. So
Right.
please explain.
Okay, so putting a human being into into a low vibrational state by creating a circumstance in their life that puts them into a depressive state would then give off an energy that they like because they like the sadness, fear, trauma, and especially tears. So somebody with their head in their hands crying is the energy is called Loosh, LOOSH, and it's very, very high powered energy. So
For
they,
them.
for them, very, very, very. So somehow calculate an event, even in dreams. I mean, I've had dreams where I've been crying in a dream, and I know that the 4D it's been mixed and done so that would happen. So they're addicted to doing that. They're also addicted to the adrenal chrome, which is in the blood, which when you bring a human being to the highest state of fear that it can be in, the most extreme state of fear, a chemical is run through the body called adrenal chrome. And if it's not a nice topic, but if the blood is then got from them at that point, that chemical adrenal chrome is inside the blood.
Yes.
So you take that, and if that is consumed, the high from the adrenal chrome is the highest high that you can get.
So
So
that's
that is sold on the black market. It's Satanists sell it.
That's why they do those rituals.
Yes. Okay. But that's one of the reasons, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Similar topic, children in cages underground. Mm-hmm. What did you see?
Okay, so I've just seen vats of children. Vats of children in disassociated states. Some crying, some not. Some gone completely, but they use this food source. They use this as to test things out on and used as a food source.
Cannibalism?
Hmm?
For meat?
Yes. Yeah.
And it is,
and also emotion. Okay, so we've got the fear energy, and the fear of a child is even more pure energy.
Yes,
for them, a more powerful energy. So to get that from a child is that children is the thing for mm-hmm. them.
And this is in Dulce.
Dulce?
Dulce?
Yeah, one of many. Yeah.
Who runs Dulce? Because there was a battle in the 60s mm. and. Humans lost.
Yeah, humans did lose. Yeah, they did. Who runs Dulce now? That's a very good question. I don't know. I know who did. I know the name of somebody who did.
Zetarticuli.
There was an MI6. The guy who did run. This is not open information. This is like hidden information. Mm-hmm. A man named Alfred Bonner, who ran from underground MI6, was known as Original Fred at Dulce, and for a time ran Dulce. Now that was 90s. 80s, so now I don't know.
Mm-hmm. And another base
with the scar on his face here, mm-hmm. which denotes German aristocracy. I mean, they have the scar down the side of their face, mm-hmm. right? Like Mengele has. There's another name, it just came to me, but I've forgotten it. It'll come back to me.
Okay, Los Alamos.
Yeah, Los Alamos is I think Los Alamos is bigger than Dulce now. I think it's probably one of the biggest bases.
And those children, are they kidnapped from?
Yeah, I mean they're also bred. They also have breeders. They'll have female breeders down
also
there.
Also slaves.
Yeah, who just are constantly breeding children for them, thousands of them. Mm-hmm. And then you've got the ones that are in the foster homes and care homes who no one really cares about. Mm-hmm. And how many street children are there? Thousands of street children. The main human trafficking, or the main child trafficking center on this planet, is Rio de Janeiro. It's where they get the most children from. Mm-hmm. They bring them up through to the U.S., U.K.
And related topic is Vatican underground.
Yeah.
What happens, this kind of magic, also with children?
Yeah. Well, okay. Well, so we're going back to the point of understanding that they're using children for everything because it's the purest and most powerful energy. Mm-hmm. So that's their thing. I think that the Vatican principle is run on it's a vampiric consciousness. Parasitic vampiric consciousness, and the Pope is a figurehead,
yes.
and nothing else.
You mean the white Pope, because there is also the black Pope.
Absolutely, yes. I don't think either of them are the one. If you see them on television, they're not in. They don't have any power.
Yes.
Okay, because they don't need to be staff. To have real power, you got to be unseen. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the Vatican, in terms of the Vatican, It's. I mean, every time I look at any of the rituals that they do in the Vatican, it's just so clearly a satanic ritual. It's unbelievable. They say Satanas in the invocations when they're doing it. I don't understand why people aren't seeing that. I think there's like a spell or something done or thrown over the masses, so they literally just don't hear or just don't see these things.
They're in a certain state of mind.
Yes, yeah. They're where they're just unable. They are. It's impossible for them to be able to see it because it's so glaringly obvious to me. I wonder why others can't see it.
There is a short film on YouTube showing that a Polish bishop, right after a ceremony, does this and goes away.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Bang. Look at that. Look at that. Okay, so you know that this is 666, but it's also the orifice. This is an orifice right here. Represents the O, okay? The negative feminine. Uh-huh. Okay, so this is that and the 3 6s too.
Okay. And during the normal church ceremony, the priest drinks the blood, eats the body, and gives the body to the people.
Right.
How would you explain that?
You mean how would I explain why they would do that ritual?
Uh-huh.
Okay. The reasoning they give?
Yes.
The reasoning they give is because they are saying that they...
Jesus gave away himself.
Yes. So yeah. if you consume him, then you become more like him. Right?
Right.
When in fact, they're just getting you to participate in the cannibalistic bloodletting ritual. Mm-hmm. Which is very, very powerful indeed.
And reinforcing their...
It's reinforcing programming. It's a very powerful ritual when you do that. When you drink that for that and you eat, it's very powerful. That's why, very powerful.
The moon.
Mm.
What is the moon?
What is the moon? What is the moon? It's not a natural object. Mm-hmm. It's an unnatural object. I think that it was part of, and it was maybe a part of something else, and it was then moved in to this specific spot now, to be used for a number of different reasons, right? As an amplification system, through Saturn. Which we can talk about, I think there's multiple bases on the moon. There's multiple Nazi bases on the moon. There's multiple Draco bases on the moon. They seem to be able to get on, the Fourth Reich and the Dracos to some extent. They seem to be able to get on to some extent. There's the soul catching machine, which is there, which is on the moon. And which is then the amnesia. So you go through the machine. I sort of have a weird sort of feeling of remembering the feeling of it, and I'm wanting to pull away. I remember being killed before. So, but you don't get a full life review. Everything is wrong with this whole system setup. You're supposed to have a life review. You're supposed to look, if you're doing this this way, look at what you've done. Look at it. There's no bad or good. There's no judgment. There's no judgment. Like, look what you did here. Now you're banished to here, banished to there. Because we're all here trying to learn and understand. So then you have a full life review. And then you come back and choose your body, choose what your higher self then chooses what conditions you need to come back into, and then you come back this way. The way that they've perverted it and inverted it is, so they've set up a system, a technological system, where they'll throw us through a machine when you die that then traps, stores the soul, erases the memory completely, and then throws you back into basically the same situation you just came from again, with the same people, just with different clothes and different. You move in circles with the same people.
How does this machine work exactly? Do you know?
Anything? No, I don't know the tech. No, I don't know the technology of it.
So it's kind of automatic, computerized technology.
Yeah, but I mean, highly advanced, highly
and
advanced.
It
obviously,
catches all the souls.
Yeah, all of them. Yeah.
But some souls are pretty much advanced, and in the
can bypass and leave.
And they like can progress in the next life.
Mm-hmm.
So it means that this doesn't work perfectly.
Well, it doesn't. No, nothing they do works perfectly. That's because that's why they're losing control now.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of like there's volunteer consciousness down here at the moment, and I would class myself and yourself as you know volunteer consciousness. Specifically, came down here to try and change the paradigm, to try and get this information out, so that we can not have to be living like this and not having to repeat the same cycles over and over and over again, because they want to stay here. They don't want to go anywhere else. That this consciousness wants to stay here, stay in this body, never get older, and continually experience the highest of high experiences, and go on. And I think that they have to have continued war. So there has to be war, rest,
yeah.
War,
thousand
rest.
1,000 years after time.
Right.
Yeah.
Because the war keeps the duality alive.
Mm-hmm.
Without war, the duality would singularize. Because you have to, war is against odds, right? One against the other. That maintains duality.
Mm-hmm.
So war is so important to them.
Okay, do you know the technology of incarnating? Like who decides if for example I want to go into this body with these parents, I decide, or something else decides?
Well, it's kind of a hard question, because in the biggest of pictures it's all your choice.
Uh-huh.
So
it means that somehow I have my free will.
You do have on the big picture, but not here though.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Once when you're here, it's pretty scripted down here.
Yeah, because recently in the last interview you said that we don't have the free will. But
we do and we don't though.
You meant here.
Yeah, yes.
When you go to the higher level, you have free will.
But you, because you're omnipotent, you're everything.
Yes.
Yes, so absolutely you do. But when you're contained in 3D physical body like this, you don't.
Mm-hmm.
You have the illusion of free will.
Mm-hmm. The full moon makes people behave in a different way.
Yeah,
so
it does.
So how does it happen that the distance between Earth and moon is the same? And just because there's more sun on the moon, the influence of the moon on Earth is different. So how physically it
because okay, with the moon is in motion and represents emotion. Okay, so when it's full, that means the light of the moon, because the sun's hitting the moon, so the light of the moon is hitting you're seeing it brighter, so its effects on the planet are going to be more intense. They just are going to be. And if it's emotions, it's going to increase and heighten up the emotions on every human being on the
mm-hmm.
planet.
Whatever emotions.
Whatever, yes, either way. I think whatever stage you're at, if you're on a high,
mm-hmm.
it increased more. And also, each moon is astrologically is going to give a different effect as well.
Mm-hmm.
An Aries full moon is going to be a different effect to a Scorpio full moon or a Capricorn full moon.
And Saturn, how is Saturn related to the moon? You mentioned earlier that they are connected.
Yeah, so we were talking about the transits, the 29.5 year transit
around
of Saturn around the sun, the 29.5 day transit of the
moon around Earth.
Okay, so they're working, so we're seeing they're working in unison there, but not numerology. Saturn used to be the life-giving sun force of this planet, and some people do call it the black sun, actually. I have heard that. It was a very beautiful, life-giving planet, and this consciousness that has taken over, whatever name you want to give it. I find it difficult to put a name on it. It's a parasitic consciousness, right? Mm-hmm. So it took over Saturn somehow, and Saturn has the highest and lowest of frequencies of all the planets. So it can have the highest frequency, or it can have the densest, lowest, most difficult frequency. So they bound it with a ring, that energy ring around it, so that, and then they trapped the lowest frequencies that it could possibly have, pushed the energy through to, there is some form of amplification system on the moon. So those frequencies are then amplified to the Earth
and focused like
this, focus down and create the false reality that's here.
Mm-hmm. And there is a lot of Saturn symbology in business.
Because it's everywhere. It's a Saturn cult. It's Saturn is you'll see the ring, even the tick on Nike shoes.
Nike, yeah.
That's
Google Chrome.
Yeah, it's too much. It's everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So because they worship it, because it's maintaining the false reality that's here.
Mm-hmm.
If there was a way to break the ring, I wonder what would happen. if we could unbind Saturn, or if it could heal itself, because at the moment it's not healed. It's sick,
yes,
right?
Yes.
As a planet.
Yes.
If Saturn could heal, the Earth would heal.
Mm-hmm. And one of the symbols of Saturn is the cube.
Sure. Because of the hexagon on top of it. Because the hexagon is a
on top,
a
top
cube.
Of the Saturn, on the north pole
uh-huh.
of Saturn.
Yes.
Okay, and the cube also symbolizes artificial intelligence.
Yes.
Because you have a binary system, so
yeah.
It's computerized.
Yes.
And you have 2 times 2 times 2.
Yes.
And the cube is to the third, third
okay,
dimension.
Cubed.
Cubed,
right. Yeah.
So it's one of this, it's related to one of the symbols of Freemasonry,
mm-hmm.
where they have this 90 degree
mm-hmm.
Angle.
Mm.
You know the symbol.
I know exactly what you're talking
yeah.
about. Yeah, the set
yeah.
square.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
that's why in a lot of rituals, a lot of the OTO rituals, when they the Ordo Templis Orientis
yes.
rituals, you have to stand with your feet at 90 degrees
mm-hmm.
as well.
And also 90 degrees means that it is fixed, like Ordnung.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
And you have to obey
yeah.
your boss.
Yes, there you go. Yeah.
Hmm?
Yes.
And Dr. Mengele?
Yeah, that's the subject.
Who is this guy, and what do you remember? Actually, we know who he was during the war. Then he escaped to the United States and continued.
Yeah. I'm not kidding you. I can see his face when I close my eyes. I can see his face now. He was mainly known for doing twinning experiments, to doing experiments on twins to see and pleasure and doing pleasure pain reversal. So pleasure means pain, pain means pleasure. One of the most evil. I mean, we're up there. One of the most evil of them all. I mean, it's pretty hard to gauge when they're all sort of like in on it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But I have, for me now, I remember disassociating so many times when I would see him,
mm-hmm.
Because that's him, that I suppose that's him programming other altars. I have one or two memories of which are vile. I don't really want to talk about them too much. Don't really want to repeat them again. But I know I can tell you that he's still alive. I can tell you he's still doing the work that he was doing, and continues at a very very high level at the NSA, and maintains his age at about 60, something like that,
mm-hmm.
with the age reduction technology they've got.
And you said he programmed,
yes,
some of your altars,
yes,
and altars,
yes,
are also kind of cubed.
More like a honeycomb.
Cubed.
Yeah, honeycomb. So yeah, so that once you if you traumatize a human being to they know exactly the levels to do it at, then the brain creates an amnesiac barrier around it, and then you are then if you're taught, you are then able to go inside there and then program a new person to do anything, mm-hmm. to do absolutely anything, and then you can bring them back to their original state. The other altar is not aware of any way of the other altar.
Mm-hmm.
So you, I think there's, there are a great number of them that can be done.
Stuart Sverdwolf wrote a book, 13 Cubed.
That's right. That's right. So I think that would be something like 6,000.
2,900 something.
2,000. Okay. Right. Okay. Mm-hmm. There you go. That's a lot. They started using that because for spies and assassins, because mm-hmm. you can't torture somebody out of information that they don't know, because it's not in
yes.
that altar.
So it means that someone is like a businessman goes to a country, then they trigger him
yeah.
to switch to another altar.
He becomes completely different. Yeah.
Then he performs some task.
Yeah.
Then they switch him back.
They often have most have front lives. The front lives. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So a regular sort of normal front life, and then they do the other things. But they may not even be aware that they're doing them.
Mm-hmm.
Some I think some are, some aren't.
Mm-hmm. Do you know any of the triggers they use on you? To switch.
Not really. I mean, I know a couple of words, but it's of no benefit.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
To do it, it has to be done with sound, usually sound, hand movement, and a word. So it's I've seen this one used a lot with a word. Which then breaks into another altar.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen Britney Spears triggered like that, and a number of Joaquin Phoenix triggered like that too. It's very sad.
Most of the singers are...
All. Yeah.
So they were trained since they were small babies.
Yes, because they got Project Looking Glass. So they know they're breeding children for positions. So that when they're breeding them,
mm-hmm.
they already know where they want to put them before they're born,
mm-hmm.
and what they're going to do with them.
So they choose also the soul,
yeah,
proper soul,
yes,
for the task.
Yes, exactly.
And they design the body.
So with the German, the Fourth Reich projects, when they were making, taking DNA from different pieces of here, piece of the mixing to make the Uberman for the Uberman project,
mm-hmm.
and then So then that draws the spirit, the soul, from whatever frequency in. It would have to, if say if you took some DNA from Osiris and you took some DNA from something else and something else put it together, you'd be pulling down a very high vibrational soul into the body, and that's what they do. That's how they do it.
Nibiru, the topic of Nibiru. As I know, in the reptilian psychology, it is this way that if there is the reptilian king, his children, the intent of his children is to overthrow him and become kings. So in the ancient times,
He would eat their children.
also, but also the children were sent to some part of the planet to perform some tasks to make them busy,
Yes.
just to prevent them
From taking over for,
taking over, yeah.
right.
And also, the children were specialized in some topics. That's why we have in the Greek and Roman mythology those gods of specific, special gods. Like this god is for performing arts, this god is for this one. So the children of some god were trained to do something so that they wouldn't kill their father. And the topic of Nibiru is, as far as I know, is also related to that, because the king of Nibiru, he was afraid of his sons, so he sent them to Earth to make them busy here. So,
Okay, so we talk about Enki and Enlil, right?
yeah.
Yes.
What do you know about those two guys and what is actually Nibiru?
It's a ship.
Spaceship.
Yeah.
It was close to Saturn in 2012.
Right. That's 12,000 year cycles.
But also not cycle because it when it can jump through a portal to another
Okay, yeah,
galaxy.
sure, okay.
Yeah, so the cycles are not important.
Right. Well, and then just in time. It takes 12,000 years for it to come back again then. But wherever it goes, it comes around in 12,000 years. Either way.
So
Okay, so Enki was for the people, for humanity, and stood and was a protector of human beings. And Enlil was still wanted to use them as slaves. So now, this is all debatable and all up for, it's what anyone thinks. So this is I'm telling you how I feel about it. So Enlil was still you wanting to use human beings as slaves to get the monoatomic gold. Well, is all the gold's gone now. But I know that they're here now. I know that those
Yeah,
two sons,
Simon Parks also says that they are
they're
now
both here.
on
Yeah.
Earth.
Oh yeah, they definitely are. Yeah, and I
In
think
body,
in phys
physically, yeah.
physical bodies, no doubt about it, and anus as well.
And so, what do they do? What do you think?
What do they do?
Are they somewhere in the
They do
here?
all their work in 4D. Okay, they could live a totally boring, humdrum, normal life, doing nothing here, but on a 4D level is where they do all their stuff.
And
And they would not be seen. They would not be. They would not be a. Tel a mu they would not be a musician or an actor or anything like that. They wouldn't be a television personality, you know. Because they would. There's much more power in being unseen.
Sigil magic. Do you know some guy who draws comics?
Yes. Yeah.
How does he do that and what
Sigil
for what?
magic is very interesting, and can be used. I think magic in general is its intent. Magic is neutral until intent is put to it. No, I just let me think. I've forgotten his name now. You have to let me think of his name. But anyway, the principles of it is if you can design any drawing or any painting or any symbol that is put onto paper, then created, and then given a charge, you can then turn that into a physical reality. You can turn that into a 3D physical reality. So you charge it through. I don't know the exact science of it, of how it works, but I just know that you are with section. If you charge the sigil, or
the sigil is a symbol.
Exactly, a symbol. If you charge it with sexual energy, then you're going to charge it with creative force energy, then you can bring that into 3D. Mm-hmm. You can manifest, and you can pretty much manifest anything into 3D with sex magic. That's their main thing.
Mm-hmm. So it means also that they can charge some kind of a symbol with intent, mm-hmm. and energy, and then they can publish that. And it makes something.
Okay, so the intent is obviously critical to the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
I nearly had his name and I've forgotten. Yeah, he does the X-Men comics. He writes a lot of the X-Men comics. He put himself into the comic books that he was writing, and then started to find out that when he'd write himself into his comic, and then what the comic he'd create, but then it would happen in his real life. So
created his life
through
on the
yes,
paper.
Yes, yes, and turned himself into a character that he wanted to be through mm-hmm. through that. And
so if he could that. If he could do that for himself, it means that Hollywood can influence, and it's of course created to influence millions and billions
of
people.
That's the main thing. Yeah, that's the thing. Hollywood is the big. Sorry, Hollywood is the biggest illusion, manipulation tool of them all. And there are good forces working within, trying to counteract the negative ones. So what you'll have happen is, you'll have a film come out, which you'll be swaying the consciousness in one direction. Then you'll have an alternative film studio put a movie out, which you'll try and sway the consciousness in the other direction to make sure so it doesn't go wrong. So they interchange characters as archetypes. So they may use Matt Damon as a Christ archetype as one point, or a Luciferian archetype as another time, mm-hmm. to switch it up to keep it confusing.
Like Terminator, in the first part mm-hmm. he was a bad guy, mm-hmm. Schwarzenegger.
Right.
And in the second part he was a good guy.
Right. I mean, but I'm talking about archetypes rather than specific character uh-huh. names. But,
okay, the film Matrix.
Yeah.
What is real in the film?
I think you can pretty much go to that movie and find a lot of the answers in there. I think there's a lot of answers in there.
Uh-huh.
I think that when that movie came out in 1999, it was a big shift. It was around the eclipse time. There was a huge full solar eclipse in August of 1999,
mm-hmm.
and that's around the time when The Matrix came out, and there was a massive jump in consciousness, human consciousness, and that movie had something big to do with it, because it impacted the world, and gave people a better understanding, even if they didn't believe, okay, that is that, it at least gave them the opportunity to muse over it, you know.
Mm-hmm. In Matrix, there is a moment when this Agent Smith interrogates Neo.
Yeah.
And for half of a second,
yeah.
they show the driver's license of Neo.
Yes, it says 9/11 on there.
Yeah, 9/11. The validity of the license is still 9/11/2001.
Right. Tells you the date of of the Twin Tower.
Yeah.
I've got about 10 movies where it shows you Back to the Future. There's a whole lot of 9/11 symbolism, because they can't do things like that. Remember, they can't create. These beings can't create. They don't have creative energy force. They don't have it. They have to take others and then do it that way. So they have to. That's called predictive programming. So they're putting these in there to slowly condition the mind to accept the fact that the towers were going to fall, and then they did. You couldn't just do it. They have to get us to do it. They essentially had to make us make the towers fall, because they can't do that.
Can they go to this heart chakra? Actually, do the reptilians have chakras and different?
I don't know the chakra system of them. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't. They see most of the attributes of the heart chakra as weaknesses though, and vulnerabilities. So they would.
They
think
perceive us as weak because we have emotions.
Yes.
And different states.
Yes.
Of
and they also perceive us as weak because we have to change form and change our body as we go through the years. Mm-hmm. They don't. They've had the same physical form through millions of years.
Mm-hmm.
So and they think that we're weaker because of that. I've noticed like a really, really big anti-God movement at the moment. Like it's coming on really, really, really strongly. They're pushing internal self, so like governed by self, you know, which is the 666 symbol. So 666 is just the number of man. Any act for self is 666. So I've seen that pushing it. They're trying to usher in the new eon. They're trying to get rid of the Christian era. Like that was when Crowley started that in 1913 with the Book of the Law, and kill off that, and then start the new eon of Horus. And it's very interesting to me because I don't know. So before the eon of Horus, there was the eon of Osiris, and before that, the eon of Isis. Eon of Isis was a matriarchal worship, and then the eon of Osiris was the worshipping of or male domination, and which was sort of still in that. Now we're going into the eon of Horus, which is the child. So it's child energy, child heart. That's what the eon. So what I was thinking about it myself the other day. What's wrong with that? What's wrong? We're always cycling through. That's cyclical is how it works here. So why is it that the other two eons were all right, and this new one is so particularly bad?
The Christianity was started by the Roman Empire. And now we still have the Roman Empire under different names, like Vatican, United States.
Yes.
Well, so they want to exchange it for a different religion?
Okay. They want a one world, a whole one world system set up, right?
Uh-huh.
One world religion, one world government, one world army.
Money.
That was a gold bug. A whole system, a centralized system, which would be more would be more efficient.
Next right.
Depopulation and then a centralized system. But they want an androgynous people. They want an androgynous because they want to be able to have the both. So that they can have both in one body. They want to have that. That's why they're pushing the feminization of man, the emasculation of women, and the Bruce Jenner thing is all predictive programming, conditioning, and showing you that look what we can do.
Mm-hmm. So the child in the morning can wake up and decide,
yeah.
I don't want to be a boy anymore, I want to be a girl.
I know, right. This is a lot of MK though. This is these are mind controlled.
Mm-hmm.
These kids have been mind controlled to do that.
Kids and also societies.
Sure.
Like in Alaska, it
mm-hmm.
happens.
In Alaska?
Yeah, I heard that.
Huh. Really?
In the schools, it is pushed so much that the school director cannot say anything against if the boy says, I'm a girl. That's it.
Really?
I'm not for sure, but some
it's
of them.
It's very
that, yeah.
fascinating.
Okay, for the wrap-up, maybe something more positive, because there were so negative
Yeah. Well, the positive thing about all of this is that it is coming to an end, and this consciousness is getting to a position where it has to give up. It has to give up. It doesn't have a choice anymore.
It's low
because the because the vibration of the planet here is raising so fast that it. I mean, it's going to hold on as long as it can, because to give up the power that it's had for so long. And remember, this war, and I've said it before, is between the priests and the scientists.
Mm-hmm.
This is an ongoing war between the priest faction and the scientists. The scientists worship self and the internal, and the priests worship the spiritual, like the spiritual God, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is the war that's going on. Even the massive atheism movement, which is tied up with a bow, which really is Satanism. Really, there's lots of parallels. They're dressing up these new sort of named philosophies, which are basically modern Satanism. Anyway, the vibration of this planet is raising very, very fast, very quickly, and as it does, there's going to be a period of chaos, because there has to be. As it raises, we're going to start seeing things for what they really look like, and they don't look like this.
Mm-hmm.
So for some people, the majority of people, it's going to be a bit of panic for a minute
mm-hmm.
there. But I think that there are people here put in place, sleeper agents as well, to know what to do at the exact time. I believe I programmed myself a long time ago to know where to be and what to do at a certain time. I trust my intuition very, very well, and I know I'm being guided and helped out all the time,
mm-hmm.
all the time.
And we can see they are panicking.
Yeah.
Like the amount of chemtrails and amount of
well, there you
propaganda.
Go. I mean, that's all fear. That's all fear stuff. It's if they're having to do that more, that means they're frightened, right? They're in a state. They're in a state of fear.
So it's
massive.
Very good news.
Yeah. it's
and,
good. Yeah.
And actually, the vibration raising
yeah.
is caused by. What by a certain position of the solar system in the
it's
galaxy?
It's the Earth itself waking up, going through sleep cycles.
Mm-hmm.
So as the Earth wakes
you mean
up,
the Kali Yuga, Dwapara Yuga.
Yeah, exactly. Okay,
mm-hmm.
so that as that happens, they there's nothing they can do about it. So they're gonna have to. Run, like get
run
off
away.
The planet. Run, literally, just do a runner.
Uh-huh.
Run away is the only choice they've got.
So they can come back after.
We're gonna face them again on another battlefield, okay,
uh-huh.
and another time in another place. They're not gonna disappear, okay. These guys don't just disappear, but I believe we're gonna have a massive reign of peace, and there will be paradise here, for a very, very, very long time,
mm-hmm.
but. They're not gone. Energy is not created or destroyed, is it?
Mm-hmm.
It just transmutes or shifts to another thing.
But is it possible that out of the panic, they would do some suicide, global suicide? Is it possible?
You mean them kill themselves
and everyone else? because
you can't, they can't do that. You can't just do that. You can't just kill everybody
using nuclear weapons.
No, it wouldn't be allowed. I don't think they would be allowed to do that. There's certain things they just can't do. You know, they've crossed so many lines and broken so many, you know, barriers.
Rules.
So many rules. Every rule. Every time they make a bargain, they break it. Every single time they make a bargain, they're the ultimate liars and betrayers. The betrayers of the galaxy. They'll say one thing to you, and they pathologically lie. I mean, lies are the easiest thing in the world to them. It's much easier for them to lie and have a false front than it is to tell the truth about anything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's the way.
That's why maybe they use the symbol of the moon. Or they use the moon, actually, because the moon reflects the sun.
Yeah.
The real light.
Mm-hmm.
The moon is the false light.
Mm, totally. Mm. Completely.
You have, we have moon and money, mono eye.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Why we have mono eye.
Right.
The triangle.
Yes. Yes. Moon eye.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought about the other day. I thought about the monkey as well, the moon key. And what does a monkey have to do with the moon? I don't know. But a moon key is an interesting thought. Okay, so the moon is feminine energy, remember, okay?
Uh-huh.
And the sun is masculine energy. Okay, now if the false reality is being amplified from the moon, which is negative feminine energy, that is what I've been trying to... I'm saying that at this point... it's what's controlling this planet is negative feminine energy, trying to emasculate the strong males on the planet who are here to protect the divine feminine, who need to protect the divine mm-hmm. feminine. So it's the false dark female, which is the moon energy, is doing that. Just wanted to clarify that one. It's a good stuff, right?
Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. That's awesome.
Thank you.